In the autumn of 2019, Black Box Theatre Company toured with their new adaptation of John Buchan's classic ripping yarn, The 39 Steps. This is a recording of that play done under lockdown conditions. A huge thank you to all our supporters and our actors who've made this possible. We hope you enjoy it. Our story begins in the winter of 1962 in a small radio studio.
Hello, Roy, love.
Hello, Bren.
Do you want a cuppa?
Oh, I'm gagging for one.
Nothing new there, then. Free sugars.
Oh, make it four. I've been stuck in this studio all day.
Do you want a biscuit?
Oh, Bren, you evil temptress.
I've got Garibaldi's, rich tea, or Bourbons.
Go on, I'll have a Bourbon.
Go on, take the last two.
Oh, you spoil me, Brenda. You really do.
What are you like? So what have they got on tonight, then?
Oh, some play or other.
Oh, that'll be nice. Makes a change. I like a nice play.
God, blimey, listen to this racket.
Gimme Perry Como any day.
Shocking.
Evening.
Oh, evening, Gov.
Oh, gosh, brass monkeys out there.
Eh, Roy. Who's that?
Eh? Oh, that's Julian, the producer of tonight's little show.
Oh, cup of tea, love.
Oh, lovely. Got any biscuits?
I've got Garibaldi's and rich tea.
Oh, got any Bourbons?
No, all gone, love.
Oh, never mind. We all set up, Roy?
Yes, Gav, just got to twiddle a few more knobs and then we're ready to go.
Right you are.
Aye, aye, shipmate.
Aye, aye, Captain has tricks.
All shipshape and Bristol fashion, your old landlord. But how's the play coming on?
Yeah, good. Just waiting for the talent to arrive. You around for a drink later?
No, I've got to get back. Battle through this snow. Have you seen it out there?
Oh, no. They reckon that 1962 could be the worst winter on record. Almost couldn't get in. I'll drink your poos next time. Love to Nigel.
Will do. Good luck for tonight, love.
Well, shipmates, you're listening to your captain of the airwaves, marvellous Michael D, and songs from yesteryear. Coming up later, we have something a little bit special for all you gorgeous listeners out there in Radioland. The Black Box Radio Theatre brings you John Buchan's classic ripping yarn, The 39 Steps. So stay tuned and stay listening to Radio 257. We leave you this evening with a personal favourite of mine. It's Glenn Miller and Moonlight Serenade.
Blimey, where is everyone? Yes? Oh, hello, love, where are you? Yes? Yes? Oh, and there's no way you can get in. Right, well, don't worry, I'm sure Terry can cover. Okay, okay, right you are. Catch up soon. Bugger, that was George. He's stuck in the snow and can't get here. Oh well, Terry will just have to cover. Yes? Oh, hello, love. Where are you? Yes? Yes? Oh, and there's no way you can get in. Right, well, don't worry. I'm sure Terry can cover. Okay, okay. Right you are. Catch up soon. Bugger, that was Reg. He's stuck in snow. Oh, well, Terry will just have to... Oh, Thelma, hello, love. What? All right. Well, it can't be helped. No, no, I'm sure Terry can... Yes, yes, catch up soon. That was Thelma. Guess what? Terry! Thank God! Where are you, love? Yes? Yes? What? Oh, bloody hell. No. Well, no, just see what you can do. Yes, right, right. Love to June. Bugger. Bugger, bugger, bugger! Well, that's it. We're buggered.
Everything all right, love?
No, not really. The entire cast is stuck in snow and we're on in 5 minutes.
Yeah, well, the weather's been shocking, hasn't it?
Yes, thank you.
Here, what about Roy?
What about Roy?
He does a bit of Amdram for the Whittington Players.
For what?
He's very good at voices. Go on, ask him. Go on.
All right. Roy.
Yes, Gav?
I understand you do a bit of acting.
Oh, you know, just a bit of Amdram stuff.
I saw his bottom last year. It was very good.
What? Oh, the dream. Yes, right. Look, Roy, all my actors are stuck in this snow, you see, and, well, not to put too fine a point on it, we're in a bit of a pickle. So I was wondering whether you might, you know, stand in.
Me? Oh, no, I don't think so. No,
oh, look,
I
old
mean...
fruit, you'd be doing me the most enormous favour.
Yeah, but I don't know the play.
You don't need to. You just have to read it and do the voices.
You're good at voices.
Yeah, there we are. What do you say?
Well, if you think...
Marvellous, marvellous. Look, you'll be fine. Look, the script's all marked up, you see. Right, I'll have to play Hannay and,
Brenda.
Brenda, right. Brenda, you can do all the female parts and do the sound effects.
What? No, I'll just do tea and biscuits.
Just reading and hanging a few things together. You've seen how it works.
Yes, but...
Don't worry, you'll be wonderful. Look, here's your script. Now, you just go over there with Roy and follow my lead. Right. Okay.
Well, that's all from me, your captain, wishing you and yours a bon voyage. Go carefully into the night, my friends, and if you can't be careful, remember, name it after me.
And you can hear more from the captain at the same time tomorrow night here on Radio 257. Later this evening, you can join Verity Smith in Poetry Corner, followed by Swing Something Easy, hosted tonight by Barry Orange and featuring Phil Fandango and his Hot Rhythm Orchestra. But now... Black Box Radio Theatre presents... The 39 Steps! God, I was bored. It was the summer of 1914. I'd only been back in the old country 3 months, and I was totally and utterly fed up. I'd left Bulawayo with a head full of dreams and a fair pile to boot, but from the off I was disappointed. In about a week, I was tired of seeing the sights, and in less than a month I'd had enough of the whole damn shooting match. It might have had something to do with the god-awful weather, of course, which made me liverish, but here I was, 37 years old, sound of wind and limb, with a pocket full of money, and yawning my head off all day. The amusements of London seemed as flat as Indian tonic water left out in the midday sun. Hannay, that's me. You've got yourself into the wrong ditch, my friend, and you'd better climb out. Ha! Fat chance. On this particularly dull afternoon, I'd spent a couple of hours at my club reading the papers and contemplating whether Albania was the sort of place that might keep a man from yawning. At 6, I dined at the Café Royal.
Would you like to see the wine list, sir?
I never dine at home. Well, why would you? Then I took in a rather dreary show at the Criterion.
Welcome to the stage, Mr. Memory.
To be honest, I really can't abide the theatre. It's all rather silly. A lot of pretty girls singing and dancing and a bunch of chaps wearing makeup and arsing about on stage. I mean, it's no way for a grown-up to make a living, is it? Anyway, I made a point of leaving at the interval and walked along the crowded streets back to the flat I'd rented just off Portland Place. At Oxford Circus, I stopped and looked up as the light drained from the evening sky, and I made myself a vow. I decided to give good old Blighty one more day to fit me into something. If nothing happened, I'd take the next boat back to the Cape. It was almost dark by the time I got back. No sooner had I put the key in the door than I had a queer feeling that something wasn't quite right. I went to switch on the light.
Don't switch on the light!
Dear God, who the deuce are you, sir?
My apologies.
As burglars and Americans go, this chap was rather polite. What the devil do you think you're doing in my flat?
Oh, I'm most awful sorry. It's a mighty liberty, I know, but you look like the kind of fella that would understand.
Understand? Understand what? And who the deuce are you, sir?
Oh, the name's Scudder. Franklin P. Scudder from Kentucky. I live in the apartment upstairs. Could I trouble you for a drink?
I beg your pardon?
A drink.
Oh, of course, dear fellow, I'm most dreadfully sorry. Where are my manners? A whiskey and soda? A gin and bitters? Perhaps a Singapore sling?
That'd be swell.
I was being sarcastic.
Oh, sorry. We don't really do sarcasm stateside.
Obviously.
Now, I understand this might look pretty damn strange.
Well, there's no doubt about it. It could look better.
But you see, Mr. Hannay, I've been watching you, and I've got a hunch you're a pretty cool customer. Someone I could trust.
How do you know my name?
It's written on your doorbell.
Oh, yes.
Now, you seem like an honest kind of fella, but one that's not afraid of playing a bald hand. Am I right?
Yes, I suppose.
Look, if you go across to the window, you'll see two fellas down on the street, but don't let them see you. Am I right?
Yes, on the corner.
They've come to kill me, Mr. Hannay.
Kill you? What on earth would possess them to do such a thing?
I've got something they won't, and I ain't prepared to give it to them.
Right. Well, as murder is on the cards, perhaps we will have those drinks after all.
Bottoms up to you, sir.
Yes, and up yours. So, what's this all about?
To put it bluntly, Mr. H, I am a spy.
How utterly fascinating. Myself, I'm a lion tamer.
No, really. I am a spy.
Okay. Well, who do you work for?
Whoever will pay me.
Oh, good. I like a man with principles.
Oh, don't get me wrong. I'm a patriot through and through. I wouldn't sell my country down the Swanee, no siree. But whether it's Uncle Sam paying the rent or good old King George, it's all the same to me.
Right. So what's this thing those chaps down there want so badly?
It's all right here, in this notebook.
Gosh, that's it.
Mr. Hannay, have you by any chance ever heard of the 39 steps?
No, should I have?
No. I guess not. But you see, it's the last piece of the puzzle, my friend.
Look, I'm sure all of this is very interesting, but what puzzle, what pieces, and who the deuce are those men?
Those men down there are part of an international underground movement who are planning to destabilize Europe and throw us all into the most terrible war.
Well, that makes no sense.
Well, none of it don't make no sense.
But why?
A clever man can make big bucks out of a fallen market, Mr. Hannay, and there ain't nothing quite like a war to send things crashing through the floor.
Crikey. You intend to stop the whole bally thing happening, is that it?
No, I couldn't stop it if I tried. No one could.
Then why?
Look, there's gonna be a war. A big war. A great war! And it's gonna change everything! But if this conspiracy goes to plan, well, England don't stand a chance. It'll lose its sovereignty. It's standing in the world. Everything! Damn it, man! It'll become a third world country, scrabbling round in the ruins for a crust of bread. Now, is that the kind of brave new world you want, Mr. Hannay?
Hell no!
Hell nah! Now, I can't tell you all the details right now, but the game, as they say, is afoot. Say, you ever heard of Constantine Carolidas?
Carolides, the Greek chappy? Yes, of course.
Well, he's the only fella that can take a wrecking ball to this plan, so they are out to get him.
You mean, kill him?
Well, I don't mean buy him a box of candy and ask him out on a date now, do I?
No, right.
Look, on June 14th, Carolidas is coming to Britain to attend a conference of international business leaders and politicians. That is when they'll do it.
Well, why can't you just warn the police or the Foreign Office or something?
Because then he'll stay home, and he needs to be here. Even Carolidas don't understand the true importance of this trip. You see, he'll be helping to cement the bonds between some of the most important nations in Europe and push for more cooperation between the Allies.
Oh, I see. Well, what about the British government or the army or something? Tip them the wink and they'll take extra precautions.
You don't seem to understand, my friend. These people ain't playing for peanuts. They're going to try their very best to kill Carolidas, but they got to do it on a big stage with the eyes of the world upon them.
Well, that's just not cricket.
I may not be able to stop this war, Mr. Hannay, but I sure as hell can try and stop them from taking out Carolidas.
Jolly good show. So, how can I help?
Well, like I said, those two goons down there have got me in their sights, so I need a place to stay for the night. They don't know you, so here's as good a place as any.
Right. And tomorrow?
Scotland.
Scotland?
Scotland. Everything leads to Wakehamshire. Now, I'm not sure why, yet, but I'm pretty certain it's got something to do with those 39 steps.
Oh, intriguing, I must say. Look, I'll make you up a bed in the spare room. You seem a decent sort of chap, but I warn you, any funny business, and I'm pretty handy with a gun.
Sounds fair enough to me.
Right. So things did occasionally happen in this god-forgotten metropolis. Scudder took the spare bed, and I had a fitful night thinking of what Franklin P. had told me. It all seemed too wild to be true, but I was willing to give him the benefit of the doubt for now. The next morning, I was up with the lark.
Brenda.
And knocking on his door with a head full of questions and a cup of tea in hand. Morning, Scudder. Fancy a spot of breakfast, old sport? Got a couple of kippers if you fancy it. There was no answer. I knocked again. Still nothing. Either this chap was the heaviest of heavy sleepers, or something wasn't quite right.
I say, Scudder.
My guest was lying sprawled on his back. There was a long knife in his chest, which skewered him to the floor. There was no doubt about it. He was dead. I'd seen dead bodies before, in the Matabele Wars, but this cold-blooded indoor business was something different altogether. So, it looked like Scudder had been telling the truth after all, and I was pretty certain that those men outside knew that he knew what he knew, and they made damn sure he wasn't going to let anyone else know that he knew that they knew what he knew. But why hadn't they finished me off as well? Surely they suspected that I knew that they knew that he knew. Or maybe, I don't know. I was in the soup, though. That was pretty damn clear. Of course, that's what they were playing for. The odds were 1,000 to 1 that I'd be charged with his murder, leaving them in the clear. Damn, they were good. There was no time to waste. Scudder may be out for a duck, but I was pretty much duty-bound for king and for country to carry on his work. I looked at my watch. Just gone 5:30. I had an idea. I had to vanish, make my way to Scotland, find the 39 steps, and then let the authorities know what the hell was going on. In the meantime, I had no doubt that Scudder's enemies would soon be on my tail, followed none too swiftly by our boys in blue. This was going to be proper boys' own stuff. A quick search revealed that Scudder's little black book was nowhere to be found. Obviously, his assailants had made off with it. I dressed quickly and threw some essentials into a small backpack. A search of Bradshaw's informed me that there was an 8:36 from St. Pancras which would get me to Scotland later that afternoon. It seemed as good a place as any to start my search. I looked out of the window to make sure the coast was clear. Damn it! The two men were still there on the corner. How the devil was I to make my escape? 5 to 6. The milkman!
I say there!
Good lummy! Yeah, don't do that, Governor! You frighten the life out of me! Gaw, blimey! My heart's panting like a blacksmith's hammer!
I'm sorry. Look, I don't suppose you'd be a brick and lend me your cap and overall for 10 minutes, would you? There's a sovereign in it for you.
Oh, yeah? Here, what's your game, then?
There are two men across the street. No, don't look round! The truth is, I've been seeing a young lady, and it turns out that one of those chaps is her brother, and the other...
Ah, don't tell me. The husband?
Spot on.
You naughty boy.
Well, I didn't actually know she was married.
Nah. Course you didn't, son, eh?
Look. I need to make a hasty exit without being recognised, if you catch my drift. What do you say?
A sovereign, you say? Well, we're all men of the world, ain't we?
Exactly.
I'm married myself.
Right.
Yeah, 24 years.
Right.
Would have gotten less for murder.
What? Oh, yes.
You know, I sometimes wish I had.
What?
Done her in.
Who?
The wife.
What?
Well, she never stops talking, you see. Morning, noon and night. Yabba, 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 yak, yak, yak. Gordon Bennett, that woman could talk for England. I says, Elsie, don't you ever give your mouth a rest. But does she listen? Nah, of course not. She's just giving it all that, isn't she? Yabba, 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 yak, yak, yak. Morning, noon and bleeding night.
Oh. Excuse me.
Yes, Governor?
Cap and overall.
Oh, right. Yes, sorry. Here we go. One cap. Here we are. And one coat.
Oh, thank you.
You know, I don't think there's a court in the land that would have sent me down if I had done her in. Here, why don't you take the horse and cart and all? Makes it look kosher. And you just leave it round the corner, I'll pick it up in a minute.
Oh, it's very decent of you.
Well, us men, we gots to stick together, don't we?
Yes, I suppose.
Yeah. Don't forget the empties. Be lucky.
Thank you. 6 o'clock. I had a couple of hours to kill, so I made my way to the station and sat in a quiet corner of the cafe and had a cup of strong black coffee.
Another cup of cocoa, sir?
Leaving it to the last moment and making sure I wasn't being followed, I hurried along the concourse to find my train.
I say, which platform for the Newton Stewart train?
Platform 3, girl.
Thank you.
You'll just catch it if you run down.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you. Excuse me. Excuse me, is this seat taken?
No.
Would you mind?
No. Help yourself, lovey.
I put my bag in the overhead rack and settled down for the long journey ahead of me. Do you mind if I smoke?
As long as it's not a pipe. I can't abide the smell. Makes me heave.
I reached into my jacket pocket for my cigarette case. And to my surprise, there it was. Scudder's notebook. The old boy must have put it in there before he was skewered. The train seemed infernally slow. After stops at Watford Junction and Northampton, we pulled into Rugby.
London! London!
boy.
That'll be a penny, mister.
Oh, there you go.
Ta. Paper, paper,
sounds like a nasty business.
I'm sorry?
The murder.
Oh, yes.
So what's it say, then?
What? A man was found stabbed this morning in a West End flat. The identity of the dead man is unknown, but police are keen to question the owner, Mr. Richard Hannay, in connection with the murder.
Is there a picture?
What?
Of the murderer? Well, give us a look, then.
There.
Oh, yeah. He looks like a proper wrong'un, don't he? Shifty eyes, you see. No, I wouldn't like to meet him on a dark night. I bet he'd do you in as soon as look at you.
Well, I don't know about that.
Oh, yes. You can see it written all over his face. Positively evil. Yes, you can tell a lot about a fella by looking in his eyes. Take you. I've been watching you.
Have you?
Oh, yeah. Now, see, you've got kind eyes.
Have I?
Oh, yes. And that face. Honest as the day is long.
Right.
Honest? But I bet you can't keep a secret, can you? Am I right? I am, aren't I?
Yes, I suppose.
There you go, you see. It's all in the eyes.
Tickets, please.
Yes, a single to Stony Cross from London.
That'll be £1, 12 shillings and sixpence. Oh, nasty bit of business down in that there London.
Have you seen his picture in the paper? The killer?
No.
Here, you don't mind, do you? Look at those eyes.
Oh, you wouldn't want to meet him down a dark alley, would you?
That's just what I was saying.
You can't trust a soul these days, not even a toff.
True.
Who'd want to live in London? Ugh. Good day. Tickets! Have your tickets ready.
He's right, you know. Dangerous place, that London. Look at that Jack the Ripper. They reckon he was a toff and all. Killed all those women he did. Never caught him, mind.
But that was over 20 years ago.
Oh, I know. But he could still be out there, lurking in the shadows. Know what I mean? No, no, no. London's not for me.
Have you ever been to London?
To London? Good Lord, no.
Oh, right.
No, 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 no. London! No, no. I've been to Brighton. That were nice. We went for a week when the kids were little. Of course, they're all grown up now. Arthur, my eldest, he's working down the abattoir with his father. And Millie, well, she's in the family way, but we don't like to talk about that. Then there's our William. He married a very nice girl from Tamworth. And the twins, well, they'll be turning 15 in November. And... oh, but listen to me, prattling on. You'll be wanting to read your results, won't you? There you go.
Thank you. Thankfully, it wasn't a very good photograph of yours truly. But I suppose there was something of the night about the face I saw staring back at me. The details in the rest of the article were sketchy at best, but it was quite clear that I was now murder suspect number one. Fortunately, that ghastly woman got off at the next station, and I wasn't disturbed again for the rest of the journey. At just gone 6:30 that evening, the train finally pulled in at Stony Cross. The small station was deserted, except for the station master who was attending to his begonias.
Excuse me, I don't suppose you know of anywhere I might get a bed for the night?
Aye, up over the hill and follow the road for about a mile until you reach McCready's place. You canny miss it. You just tell him Hamish sent you.
Oh, thank you. Oh, by the way, I don't suppose you've heard of the 39 Steps, have you?
The 39 Steps? No. Is it a pub?
I'm not sure.
The 39 Steps? I canny say I have. There's the Three Chimneys this side of Kirkcudbright. Although, after the storm last year, they've only got the one chimney left. There's the Six Bells the other side of Castle Douglas. But No, I can't say I've heard of the 39 steps.
Well, thank you anyway. Good day.
Aye. Oh, there's the four feathers at Del Beatty. There's a very nice Sunday roast.
The day was drawing in by the time I found the small cottage. Good evening, Miss McCready.
Mrs.
Oh, sorry, yes. Hamish, the station master, said you might have a bed.
Aye, if you don't mind topping and tailing with me and my husband.
What?
I hope you haven't got cold feet.
Eh?
Ugh, away with ye. I'm only joking. Come in. We've got a spare bed in the loft, if that'll do you.
Oh, yes, right. That'll be fine.
Will you be wanting something to eat? You look famished.
Oh, I am rather.
Well, we can't have you wasting away now, can we? A fine figure of a man like yourself.
Thank you.
From England, are you?
Yes.
I went to England once. Didn't care for it much, truth be told. I couldn't understand a word most of them were saying. So whereabouts in England are you from?
Bath.
Oh, Bath. Fancy. Well, ham and eggs, do you?
Oh, ham and eggs will be lovely.
Right. Well, I'll show you to your room. Rory, that's my husband. He'll be home soon, so supper will be in about half an hour, if that's all right. By the way, I didn't catch your name.
Hanley. Dickie Hanley.
Right you are, Mr. Hanley.
She showed me to a small but cosy room in the eaves of the house.
Now, if you need me for anything, just shite.
Sorry?
Shite.
Oh, shout.
Aye, that's what I said. Shite.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I will. Half an hour later, I was sat opposite Rory, a giant of a fellow with arms like legs of mutton. He was a man of few words.
So, you're from which? England.
Yes, Bath.
Is that near London?
No, not really.
Oh. Did you hear about the murder?
Sorry?
The murder.
Once more.
Oh, the murder. That fella in London.
Oh, the murder.
Aye, that's what I said. Murder.
Yes, I read something about it in the papers on the way up.
They say this Hannay killed his lodger in a fit of temper, stabbed the poor wee fella to death.
Oh, no, I don't have... Oh, didn't realise that he had a lodger.
Oh, aye.
Oh, right, yes, shocking business.
Shocking indeed, Mr. Hanley.
The rest of the meal was conducted in relative silence, and once finished I made my excuses and retired to my bed. There'd been something about Rory's demeanour over the ham and eggs that made me feel ill at ease. With my picture now adorning the front pages of every newspaper from Arbroath to the Isle of Wight, it wouldn't be long before someone put two and two together. But I comforted myself in the knowledge that we were in the middle of nowhere, and I was pretty certain arithmetic wasn't Rory's strong point. At 5 the next morning I awoke, dressed, and was about to make my way downstairs, when Rory burst into the room.
It's the police! They're on their way. Margaret recognised your photograph from yesterday's Scotsman, and well, she does like to interfere. I've just got one question for ye. Did you do it, Mr. Hannay?
No.
Aye, well, that's good enough for me. Come on, if you go down the back stairs, you can make a run for it. I'll try and stall them as best I can, but you'd better hurry.
Who'd have thought it? Good old Rory. I was down the stairs and out the back door in a flash. As I made my way across the fields, I could see a car drawing up to the front of the house. It looked like the chase was on. I decided to follow the railway line to a station or two along from Stony Cross, and then double back. The police would naturally assume I'd be heading north and west, perhaps to a port to make my escape, when in fact I'd be heading back east and south. The station, while I found it some hours later, was perfect, remote. I saw the steam of a train some way off and approached the tiny booking office. Excuse me, is that the train to Dumfries?
Aye.
A ticket then, please.
A ticket?
Yes.
Where to?
Sorry?
Where to?
Dumfries.
Dumfries?
Yes.
And, when are you coming back?
I'm not.
Oh, are you sure?
Yes, pretty sure.
Because a return ticket is only a shilling more than a single.
Well, fine, I'll have a return then. But could you hurry? I'm in a bit of a rush.
Now, are you coming back today?
Does it matter?
Well, you'll either be wanting a day return or a return.
Well, a day return will be fine.
So you are coming back today?
Well, yes, I suppose.
So, that's a day return to Dumfries.
Yes.
That'll be 5 shillings exactly.
I handed over a £1 note.
Oh! Have you got anything a bit smaller?
No.
Oh, we don't carry much change, you see. Hold on. Maureen! Have you got any change for a £1 note?
£1 note?
This gentleman hasn't got anything smaller.
I might have something in my purse. Just hold on one
moment.
Look,
I really am in the most awful hurry.
Oh, she'll only be a wee while.
But the train, it's just...
Aye.
Look, just give me the ticket and you can owe me the change.
Ach, no! Can he be doing that? There's rules and regulations to this kind of thing. Maureen will only be a... Oh, look, here she is. So, that's... 6, 7, 8, 9... Oh! That's a button, Maureen. How did that get in there? 10, 11, 12. Oh, no, I've dropped a sixpence somewhere. Let me find that. Where'd that little beggar go? Where are you? Got it. Where did I get to?
12 shillings.
Oh, aye. 13. 14. I hope you've got deep pockets, mister. There we are. Have you got another halfpenny, Maureen?
Really, it doesn't matter. Could you just...
There we are. And a halfpenny makes a pound. So, that's a day return to Dumfries.
Thank you.
Well, now there's a man in a hurry.
I will. That's the English for ye. Cannot wait to leave.
I made the train as it was just pulling out of the station. The only occupants of the carriage I was in were an elderly fellow and a rather angry-looking dog. The man was asleep, but on the seat beside him was a copy of That Morning Scotsman. I picked it up only to be confronted by his snarling companion.
I'll give it back, I promise.
There were 2 columns about the Portland Place murder, as they were now calling it, and another photograph of yours truly. Mr. Richard Hannay, a mining engineer who recently returned to England from Rhodesia, has been described by local police as the prime suspect in the murder of the unknown victim found in the flat off Portland Place. Blah, blah, blah. If you see a man answering his description, tall and devastatingly handsome, do not approach, as he is likely to be armed and highly dangerous, but inform your local station immediately. There was little else of interest, nothing of foreign politics or of Carolides. My plan was to get out at some station before we arrived at Dumfries, put my pursuers off the scent. But, as luck would have it, a few miles further on, the train came to a halt just before a small bridge spanning a fast-flowing river.
Is this Glasgow?
No, sir.
Are you sure?
Pretty sure.
Aye. You? I haven't been drinking. Anti-total, son. I've taken the pledge. Not a single drop has passed my lips. Except for a medicinal purposes. And I won't have you say any different. Aye, shit, you noise.
I opened the carriage door. Well, very nice to have met you. Charming dog. I dropped down into a tangle of hazel which edged the line, leaving the old soak and his dog to fight it out between themselves.
Are you quite sure this isn't Glasgow, isn't it? Where the hell's he going? Aye, will you shut your noisy wee beastie, isn't it? Oh, God. Oh, Jesus Christ almighty! He's gone! He's gone and jumped to his death! Guard! Guard!
I couldn't have made a more public departure if I'd left the carriage with the Argyllan Butte pipe band playing Scotland the Brave. I crawled through the thicket and made my way along the stream, putting 100 yards or so between me and the train before looking back. The guard and several passengers were now gathered around the open carriage door. Fortunately, everyone's attention was aimed at the old gentleman trying in vain to control his now hysterical dog. I carried on and followed the river for several miles until the landscape changed to open moorland. For the first time, I felt exposed and began to feel the terror of being a hunted man. I knew the police had me in their sights, but what of Scudder's murderers? Were they on my tail too? My heart pounded in my chest, but I pressed on. The moor soon gave way to higher ground. The climb was arduous, but eventually I reached a ridge and stopped to survey the green fields below. It was then that I heard it. The unmistakable noise of an aeroplane engine. I scanned the skies. There it was, to the south, a monoplane climbing into the heavens. That wasn't the police. It flew low along the hilltops before rising again, circling and repeating its search. I stayed down, hidden from view in the dense heather. At long last, it seemed to change its mind, rose high into the blue sky, and headed back south. I didn't like this business of espionage from the sky. It just wasn't British. After making sure the plane wasn't coming back, I left the sanctuary of the ridge, made my way over the hill, and dropped down to a white ribbon road. I walked until my feet began to blister. It had gone 9 in the evening, and with the light fading, I eventually came across an isolated inn.
Good evening! It's a fine night for the road.
Yes.
Are you after a room?
Yes.
Oh, that's grand. We haven't had a guest for a week or more. I take it you're not from these parts.
No, I'm here from South Africa on a walking holiday.
South Africa, you say? Very exotic.
Ah, no, not really.
Well, you're very welcome, Mr.
Henley. Damn it, I really should come up with a better nom de plume.
Mr. Handley. Well, come in, come in. Take a seat at the bar and warm yourself by the fire. I'll fix you up with a nice single malt, perhaps. You look like you could use one.
You have no idea. One single malt turned into two, which soon turned into quite a session.
Oh, you'll like this one. It's from the Isle of Jura. You'll notice the peaty undertones with a hint of toffee and a slight aftertaste of gunpowder.
Goodness, you're not wrong. Ian was a most genial host. It turned out he'd travelled a bit and had aspirations of being a writer.
Aye, but my father passed away some months ago and left me this place. It's not exactly what you would call a going concern, though.
No, I suppose not.
But gives me plenty of time to scribble. Anyway, tell us more about yourself, Mr. Handley. South Africa. Now there's a place. I bet you've got a tale or two to tell.
Well, it turns out that a good single malt or six loosens the tongue exceedingly well. And before long, I was regaling mine host with stories of the colonies.
A lion, you say? And nothing but a violin and a bottle of brandy to defend yourself with? Heavens.
Suddenly, the bell on the front desk rang.
Well, how about that? Not a soul for a week, and now you're like buses. Excuse me one moment.
It might have been a coincidence that another guest should happen upon the place, but I'm not sure I believe in coincidences.
I don't suppose you've seen a stranger about the place.
A stranger?
Yeah, an Englishman.
An Englishman? No, I can't say I have.
Are you sure?
Ugh, we don't get many strangers passing. I think I remember. But, if we did, who may I say is asking after them?
Police.
Police?
Yeah.
The police? Right.
I don't suppose you've got a room.
No, sorry. We're fully booked.
Really?
Aye.
Well, perhaps we could come in for a drink.
A drink? Have you seen the time? I was just away to my bed. No, sorry, gentlemen. You'll have to be on your way. I've a busy day tomorrow with the breakfasts and laundry and what have ye.
Well, if you do see anything unusual...
You'll be the first to know, officer. Good night now.
Well.
Thank you. But why didn't you hand me in?
If they were police, you can call me Morag. Besides, I know every policeman within 20 miles, Mr. Hannay. Your face is all over the papers. I recognised you as soon as you walked through my door.
Oh.
You don't have to worry. But, out of curiosity, did you do it?
No.
Oh. Well, we won't let facts get in the way of a good story now, will we? Now, I think we need another wee dram. I've got something a bit special from the West Isles. It's got hints of seaweed, carbolic soap, and kippers. I've been saving it for just such an occasion. I mean, it's not every day you get a fugitive on the run turn up on your doorstep, is it now? So come on, come tell Uncle Ian all the juicy bits.
Oh, and I did. I pitched him a lovely yarn. I made out that I was a mining magnate from Kimberley who'd had some troubles after a botched deal with a rather ruthless gang.
Diamonds? Fancy.
Yes. They pursued me across ocean and desert and finally tracked me down to a flat in London. That's where they killed my best friend, and now they're on my trail again. You want a story? Well, now you've got one.
It's proper Conan Doyle stuff, this.
Look, could you put me up for a few days?
You can lie as snug as a bug, my friend. And you can give me more details of your adventures. I feel a ripping yarn coming on.
He gave me a room at the back of the house, which gave me a chance to finally sit down in real earnest to study Scudder's notebook. Most of it made little or no sense. A lot of times and places and foreign-sounding names. Some of it was written in code, a numerical cipher of some sort. It took me a while, but I cracked it. A was J, so represented by X. E was U, which equaled XXI, and so on. Clever, but not overly complicated. Anyway, with a bit of work, I had it, and one name stood out. The Blackstone. The Blackstone. It was the name Scudder had given to our erstwhile friends and, unsurprisingly, our deadly foe. But it was the last entry in the notebook that had me intrigued. It read, The 39 steps. I've counted them. HT2217. What on earth could it mean? Scudder had mentioned the 39 steps back in London, but HT2217? It had me stumped. For the next 2 days, I read and reread Scudder's words, trying to connect the dots, but without much success. There was one thing I could surmise. What was contained in this little black book was apparently worth killing for, and the Blackstone knew it must now be in my possession. It was obvious it was they who were now hard on my trail. There was only one thing to do. I had to keep moving. On the afternoon of the second day, I sent Ian off on his motorcycle to get me the paper, and he set off like a docile child.
Cheerio!
He'd already told me his father's old car was in a small barn at the back of the house. I soon found the keys, and scribbled a line or two of thanks and apologies to my host, grabbed some bread and cheese from the larder, and slipped away. I had no clear purpose in my journey, but a hastily drawn map in the notebook suggested I needed to go north. I kept the smaller roads, and for the first 40 minutes or so, I saw no one as I drove steadily on. It soon occurred to me, however, that driving a large green motor car through Scotland might not go unnoticed for long, and if that infernal aeroplane came back, I'd be a sitting duck. There was nothing for it. I had to abandon the old girl. I found a wooded area and pulled the car off the road. It made sense to keep following the track, but on foot, and see where it led me. I can't have been walking more than about 10 minutes when I heard a car coming up behind me. Damn it, there was nowhere to hide. On one side of the road was a sheer face of granite. The other fell away into a deep gorge. I was trapped.
I say, is that your motor back there? Everything okay?
Yes. Small problem with the carburetor, I think.
Oh, bad luck. Well, look. Hop in. I'm only up the road.
You really don't have to.
Don't be a clod. Jump in.
Okay. Thanks.
Emily Hamilton, but everyone calls me Em.
Richard Twiston.
Twiston? No relation to old Tommy Twiston?
No, I don't think so.
Lucky you. Dreadful old goat. So what brings you to these parts?
A holiday.
Marvellous. Where are your bags?
Well, this is pretty much it. I'm a colonial and travel light.
A colonial? By God, Mr. Twiston, you could be the answer to a maiden's prayer. Are you by any chance a free trader?
I hadn't the foggiest notion what a free trader might be.
Well, a free trader? Oh, yes.
Marvellous. Look, I'm canvassing for the Unionist Party in these parts, and, well, we've got a meeting out in Battleburn this evening, and my main speaker's not turned up. Something about catching the influenza in Blackpool or some rot. Anyway, you'd be doing me the most awfully big favour if you could step in and say a few words. I'd do it myself, but I get frightfully tongue-tied in front of a large crowd. But for you fellows, you've got the gift of the gab, haven't you? Just give them something about protectionism being a washout in the colonies or something. I'd be forever in your debt. Marvellous, marvellous. You're a brick. Look, you can wash and brush up at the house, grab a bite to eat, and I can sort you out with one of Father's old suits. God rest his tight-fisted old soul. Yours does look a bit,
Yes.
Yes, anyway, he was about your size.
Right.
Right!
A couple of hours later, I was sat on a stage in a large hall, in front of a crowd made up mostly of women in big hats, and old men in small hats.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Lady Emily Fortescue Hamilton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Righto. Well, now then, yes, Hello!
Her speech was truly awful. She muttered something about the German menace.
The German menace.
The Tory intervention to cheat the poor.
Cheating the poor?
And, but for the Tories, Germany and Britain would most likely be fellow workers in peace and reform.
Peace and indeed reform.
A fat lot scudders fans talk about peace and reform.
Thank you, thank you. But I have waffled on for far too long. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, it is my great pleasure to introduce a fellow free trader and one of my dearest friends who has kindly come to talk to us this evening, Mr. Richard Twisden.
Thank you. Good evening, and I must start by saying what an unexpected pleasure it is to be here in Scotland with you all. I then went on for about half an hour, talking about Australia's Labour Party, emigration, and universal service, hoping to God there were no actual Australians in the audience. I don't know whether the assembled throng were captivated and engrossed by what I had to say, or utterly bewildered and confused, but they all kept quiet until I signed off, and then applauded with some gusto.
We'll all leave here tonight, knowing more than we did when we arrived.
That I doubted very much.
Now, does anyone have any questions for our esteemed speaker? Yes, the young lady in the, if I may be so bold, very alluring purple dress.
Yes, good evening. And no, you may not be so bold, Archie MacGregor. Mr. Twisden, I couldn't help noticing as you were expanding on the notion of nation helping nation and neighbour helping neighbour, which of course I thoroughly concur with.
Where was this going?
That you bear an uncanny resemblance to the Portland Place murderer that we've all been reading about.
Yes. I'm afraid I'm cursed with one of those faces that seems to remind people of other people.
But it is really rather remarkable. You could be twins.
A hum went around the hall.
Ladies and gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, please can we have some order, order?
There was no way of talking my way out of this one. They were on to me, but before I could gather my thoughts, the long arm of the law was feeling my collar.
Excuse me, Mr. Twisden, but are ye in fact a Mr. Richard Hannay of Portland Place, London, England?
Oh dear. I'm afraid, officer, there's been a most dreadful mistake. The 39 steps will continue after a short break. So, join us again for the second installment of The 39 Steps. You join us again for the thrilling conclusion of tonight's play, The 39 Steps.
So, for the record, Mr. Twisden, you are in fact a Mr. Richard Hannay of Portland Place, London, England. Is that correct?
Yes, near enough.
And on the 7th of June, you murdered a gentleman in said flat in or near Portland Place.
No.
What do you mean, no?
No.
No?
Yes.
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 Wait, 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 hold on, hold on. Are you saying yes, you didn't kill him, or yes, you did kill him?
No.
No, you did, or no, you didn't?
Yes.
Oh, dear Lord. Look, did you kill a man in your flat? Yes or no?
No.
But it says here you did.
Well, I'm telling you I didn't.
Right. So you're saying there wasn't a murder in your flat?
No.
So you're saying there was a murder in your flat?
Yes.
Oh dear, I can see we're gonna be here all night. Right, let's start again, shall we?
Here, Sarge.
What is it, lad?
There's two fellers at the front desk. Said they've come to take the prisoner to Kilmarnock for questioning.
Oh, thank Christ for that. I want to be away for my tea. Right, you, come on.
Is this Hannay?
Aye, well, I think so. He's not been very cooperative.
Okay, we'll take it from here.
They cuffed me and bundled me into the back of a large black car, and we drove off into the night. Eventually, we pulled off the main road and followed a narrow, winding track.
I say, is this the correct way to Kilmarnock?
Shut it.
Look, there really has been the most dreadful mistake.
Look, I told you to shut it. Now pipe down.
The two men whispered something to one another. I couldn't quite make it out. In fact, it didn't sound much like English at all. After a while, we swung into the drive of a modest country house.
Out!
These two coppers were playing rough, and I was pretty certain this wasn't Kilmarnock. Once inside the house, I was marched into a room lined with bookcases, pictures of wildfowl, and mounted stag's heads. Sat at a desk was a small, rotund man, not unlike Mr. Pickwick.
Mr. Hannay.
He nodded to one of the gorillas to remove my manacles.
Who are you? I'm guessing you're not the police.
No, indeed.
Well?
A friend, Mr. Hannay.
Really?
If you like. I have a little proposition for you. A private settlement, if you like.
Who the deuce are you, sir?
Oh, of course. My name is Professor Baron von Schwepstein Winkelberger the Third. But my friends call me Boris.
A professor and a baron. How very Teutonic.
How very dare you, sir. I am Austrian.
Oh, right. So, if you're not the police, who do you work for?
No one. Not really. I'm a member of an elite organization called... the Blackstone.
The Blackstone?
I suspect you knew that already.
No, I can't say I'm familiar with it.
You've been a hard man to track down, Mr. Hannay.
Yes, I've been on a bit of a jaunt. So, what do you want?
I believe you may have some information that may be of some interest to us.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, come, come. Your friend Scudder had been following us for quite some time. But then again, we were following him. It is the nature of these things. His notebook, Mr. Hannay, you have it.
No.
Search him.
One of the monkeys searched my pockets and patted me down, while the other held a gun on me.
Nothing.
Where is it, Mr. Hannay?
I don't have it.
Mr. Hannay, let us not play games. It is so unseemly.
Look, I really don't know what you're talking about. Scudder came to my flat and introduced himself as my new neighbour. He'd just moved in. We had a few drinks, chatted about nothing in particular, put the world to rights, you know. He explained that his furniture hadn't arrived, and would I mind putting him up for a couple of nights? Next morning, he was dead. I panicked and ran. That's it.
Ah, wunderbar, wunderbar. That is very good, very good. Of course, I don't believe a word you understand. But look, a man with your ingenuity and spunk, I think you'll say, could be a great asset to us. You must think about it. But now, I have a very important dinner date this evening, so you will excuse me. Can I suggest you take some time and perhaps come up with a better story? You might also like to think about which side of your bread you wish to be buttered, mein friend. Gute Nacht. Carl, lock him in the storeroom!
I was marched out of the room with a pistol in my ear.
There was no doubt about it. I had somehow ended up in the wolf's lair and found myself in a bit of a pickle. Fortunately for me, I'd left Scudder's notebook in my old jacket pocket, which was back at Lady M's. And whilst it was safe there, for a while at least, I wondered about my own fate. Perhaps the notebook contained more than I thought, and that might just buy me some time. But I don't mind admitting, my resolve was beginning to falter.
Damn it, man! Pull yourself together! After all, you're British!
My prison was a dark, damp room that smelled of disuse. I groped around in the darkness. There were boxes and sacks full of what looked like dog biscuits and smelt of cinnamon. As my eyes became accustomed to the gloom, I could see some kind of cupboard or laundry press against the wall nearest me. Locked. Well, in for a penny. I listened carefully for any noise from outside my prison door. Nothing. The cupboard contained bottles and jars of what looked like various chemicals, coils of fine copper wire and yanks of thin oiled silk. I knew what this was. I hadn't worked in the mining industry for nothing. I rummaged around some more. Yes, a box of detonators, and inside a metal case, half a dozen small grey bricks, each a couple of inches square. Explosives! I'd never actually handled explosives before, you understand, not my department, but it was a chance. Perhaps my only chance. I took out a detonator and fitted it to a couple of feet of the silk fuse. Then I connected that to one of the grey bricks and buried it at the base of what I thought was most probably an outside wall. I had no idea whether it was going to go off like a Chinese firecracker or blow the whole damn place, including myself, from here to next week. Damn it! One match left. I held my breath and lit it. With as steady a hand as I could manage, I lit the fuse and quickly moved back behind a pile of boxes and dog biscuits. Well, certainly not a firecracker. Once the dust had settled a bit and the ringing in my ears had subsided, I realised the explosion had done the trick. Not a huge hole, but big enough to squeeze through. I could hear shouts and running footsteps in the corridor outside the door. It was now or never. I scrambled through the tight hole and found myself standing in a small yard, full with the dense, acrid fog of smoke and dust. Choking, I staggered blindly forward, away from the house. Suddenly, a gunshot. Then another. I ran, stumbling and falling over myself into the darkness. It wasn't long before I found myself in the woods, but I could still hear shouts in the direction of the house. I had to keep moving. I followed a stream for about a mile or so until I came across a road of sorts. Fortunately, the moon was up, which allowed me some visibility. It couldn't have been more than a few minutes before I heard a car coming up behind me. I quickly left the track and lay down amongst the heather. Headlights swung into view, lighting up the road ahead. I kept my head down as the car sped past. It was the same car that had brought me from the police station earlier that evening. Once out of sight, I continued my journey along the moonlit road. It felt like I'd been walking the best part of the night when I came across a small farmstead. I was exhausted and needed somewhere to rest. There was a barn,
perfect. A pile of straw in the corner made for a very comfy bed. The next morning I was rudely awoken by a burly woman prodding me with the handle of a large axe.
Oi, you, get up.
What?
Come on, get up.
I wasn't going to argue. I'm most awfully sorry.
Are you hungry?
What?
Are you hungry? I've got some porridge on the stove.
Well, that would be... Yes, thank you.
Right, well, come on.
I don't know what she took me for, but like a true Samaritan, she asked no questions, but fed me and even gave me a mug of warm milk with a dash of whiskey. Thank you. You're most awfully kind. I don't suppose you know the way to Tweedsmuir Lodge, by any chance?
No.
Battleburn?
Oh, aye. That's about 15 miles due south of here. Is that where you're heading?
Yes, I've got a friend to meet.
Well, that's a mighty long walk. Perhaps you should borrow my bicycle.
Oh, no, I couldn't.
Don't be daft, of course you can. Just leave it at the post office, and I'll pick it up next time I'm passing through.
Really?
Aye.
Well, that's most awfully generous of you.
Oh, away with ye. Think nothing of it. I'd give you a ride myself, but I don't have a fancy motor car. And Brendan, that's my husband, well, he's taking the horse and cart to market. You'll most likely pass him on his way back.
I don't mind admitting, but I was almost overcome with gratitude for the generosity of this stranger. Oh, thank you. After breakfast, I took to the road again on the rather ancient bicycle. Cheerio and thank you. By mid-morning, I had Battleburn in my sights. Excuse me, do you know the way to Tweedsmuir Lodge?
Lady Emily's place, aye.
Oh, good. Would you mind telling me?
Oh, aye. You want to go straight on through the town, and when you get to the church, turn right and follow that road for about a mile. Then left at the bridge, and when you get to the fork in the road, go straight on past a wee loch and follow your nose.
Right, thank you. I pulled my hat down and cycled through the town as fast as I could. I didn't want to be recognised and collared for a second time.
Oi, slow down, you lunatic.
Well, I didn't. I cycled like my life depended on it, which of course it did. But it appeared that there was a flaw in the directions I'd been given. Whether it was the right at the church, or the left at the bridge, or the nose-following bit, who knew? But an hour and a half later, I finally stumbled on Tweedsmuir Lodge, more by accident than by design. I rang the bell.
Good Lord, it's you!
Hello, Em.
Hello? Did they let you go?
Not exactly.
Look at the state of you. Oh, look, don't just stand there. Come in. I was terribly worried about you. They said you'd been taken to Kilmarnock for questioning. Are you all right?
I'm absolutely fine. And all the better for seeing you.
Really? Oh, do you want a drink? Looks like you could do with one.
Oh, thank you, yes.
So, what happened?
There was nothing for it but to tell Lady M the whole story. And the notebook is still in my old jacket, which I left here.
Well, I may not be good at much, Mr. Hannay.
Richard, please.
Richard? But I'm a fair judge of character. You're no murderer. Anyone can see that. And you're no fool, either. And I believe you're speaking the truth. Now, you need to talk to my godfather, Sir Walter Bullivant. He's a dear old thing. Foreign Office. It so happens he's up here on a shooting party or something. I'll drive you over.
Oh, rightio. Thanks, Em.
Pleasure. Look, I'll give him a call. Let him know we're on our way over. Gosh, this is all jolly exciting. Help yourself to another drink.
Later that afternoon, we were sat in a room full of books and trophies and untidiness and comfort. If ever I had a house of my own, I would create
just such a room.
Well, my boy, M says you have something that will wake me up.
Tell him what you told me.
I began at the very beginning. It seemed like a jolly good place to start. I told him of my boredom in London and the night I came back to find Scudder in my flat.
Cheeky blighter, typical Yank.
I told him about Carolides.
Ah, yes, a good man.
And the Foreign Office conference.
Yes, that would make sense.
Then I got to the murder.
Damn poor show.
And the milkman.
Game fellow.
My time in Wigtonshire and deciphering Scudder's notes.
And you have the notebook here?
Right here, sir.
Ah, good man. Well, Hannay, you can dismiss the police from your mind, dear boy. I can guarantee you're in no more danger. At least, not from the law of this land.
Have they called a murderer, sir?
No, not yet, but I received a letter from our man Scudder, and I knew him a little. He'd done a couple of jobs for me. Mad as a hatter, of course, but wholly honest. It arrived yesterday.
But he's been dead a week.
Ah, the letter was actually written and posted on the 12th of last month. He sent it via Spain, then on to Newcastle, back to the French Riviera, on to Oslo before it arrived here. He liked to cover his tracks.
But the 12th? That was 3 weeks before I met him.
Such are the machinations of the spy world, Hannay. He would have had an eye on you for quite a while before making contact.
Oh, I see. What did he say?
Not a great deal. Merely that he had some interesting information he needed to share. Feared that he was in some kind of danger and was being followed. But that he had a plan to stay with a friend and that I would hear from him before the 14th of June. Today! No address. Just said he was living near Portland Place. Anyway, after I heard about the murder, I concluded you were the friend, made inquiries about you, and, well, I guessed at the rest. I think the object of the letter was to clear you if anything untoward should happen.
Gosh.
May I have a look at the notebook?
Of course. Most of it's in some kind of code. I explained the cipher as I understood it, and we spent a good hour working through it, Sir Walter amending a few of my interpretations as we went along.
Jolly good work, though, Hannay. First class. But, all this about the war and the Blackstone reads like a penny dreadful. I'm not sure I really have complete confidence in Scudder's assessment of the situation at all. He had an artistic temperament, you see, and always wanted a story to be better than God intended. I mean, all this about Carolides being bumped off? There isn't a country in all of Europe that wants Carolides gone. No. I'm afraid he's way off the mark there. However, this stuff about the Blackstone, Der Schwarzstein. Yes. Now, I think a certain European power is far too interested in our naval deployments. There's definitely some nasty business afoot, and the old boy found out too much, and I'm afraid paid the ultimate price.
Excuse me, sir. There's a trunk call from London. Apparently it's urgent. Sir!
Thank you, Rogers. I'll take it in here. Yes? Bullivant speaking? Yes? Yes? When? Oh, right. Thank you. Well, Scudder, my sincerest apologies, old boy. Carolides was shot this evening at a few minutes after 7. It looks like it started.
Sir Walter spent a busy hour on the phone to the First Sea Lord and the Secretary of War.
Apparently, we've got a leak in the department. Some vitally important papers regarding our naval dispositions have gone missing. What a belly mess. This murder of Carolides will play the deuce right across Europe. I'm afraid Scudder was right. War is almost inevitable now, and if these naval defence plans get out of the country, it will leave us wide open.
Couldn't they just change the dispositions?
They could, but we want to avoid that if possible. An immense amount of planning has gone into all this, and no alteration would be anywhere near as effective at defending this island. Besides, if your friends were clever enough to discover the original plans, then they would be clever enough to discover the change. Damn it!
But surely, if the Blackstone have the plans, they could have already posted them or phoned them through.
No, Em, you don't understand the habits of a spy. He would be instructed to personally deliver the information.
So, there is still a chance. We've still got time.
Well, if they haven't already left the country, yes.
What about the notebook? There must be something in there. The Blackstone, the 39 steps.
The what?
The 39 steps.
Please, show me.
Here, it's the last entry. The 39 steps. I counted them. HT2217.
Yes, but what does it mean?
Oh, I don't know, sir. It's got me stumped.
Let me have a look. It's not HT2217. It's high tide 2217. 10:17 p.m.
Ah, of course, you clever old stick.
It could be the time and place they're leaving from.
Very likely. But we don't know the date. And we don't know where these 39 steps might be. They could be anywhere from Broadstairs to Aberdeen.
Yes, but look, it would make sense if they based themselves up here and were trying to get back to the continent, then they'd leave from the northeast coast.
Which, with the greatest of respect, dear boy, is still well over 300 miles long.
Look, I used to do a bit of sailing in my youth, and high and low tides occur at different times and at different parts of the coast.
So?
Well, if we could figure out where the next high tide is at exactly 10:17, we could at least pin it down to a few miles.
Rogers! Rogers!
Yes, sir?
Get me a map.
Of anywhere in particular, sir?
Britain, man, Britain!
Have you got tide tables?
Yes. Must do somewhere. Admiralty stuff, you know. Hannay, you look over there, and I'll say a little crap here.
No. I've got it.
Good man.
Right. I think we can discount harbours or docks. It must be somewhere like a cove or cliffs with a staircase down to the water. Somewhere where a high tide matters. A bit of open coast away from prying eyes.
If they wanted to get back to, say, Bremerhaven or Hamburg, where would they set sail from? Come on. Got it. Here.
What am I looking at?
These are the tide times for next week, you see. High tide is either too early or too late in a few days' time. But look here. June 15th. Tomorrow, there's a high tide between 21:12 and 22:53, stretching from North Berwick to Bamborough, Northumberland.
Ah, that's still a lot of coastline.
What about here? Bradgate, high tide 22:27.
Where is it on the map?
Here.
But in the notebook, it specifically says 22:17.
Oh, surely that's close enough.
No, he's right. It has to be 22:17, otherwise we could be miles out. It has to be precise. That's where we'll find the 39 steps.
And I'm positive that's when and where the Blackstone will be making their escape.
Rogers, get me the Coast Guard at Bradgate on the phone.
Sir?
Someone there must know of these 39 steps.
Worth a shot.
He's at the Coast Guard at Bradgate. Hold the line, please. Sir Walter!
Hannah, you better take this.
Right. Yes, hello. I'm calling from the Foreign Office on behalf of Sir Walter Bullivant. Yes, that's right. Look, can you tell me,
Are there any cliffs near Bradgate? No, we're looking for a place where there might be steps down to a beach. No, more like a staircase. Brattlesham. Look it up on the map. By the golf course? No, it's got to be more remote than that. Well, think, man, think. This is of national importance. The Rough. Yes. 2 miles south of Bradgate, yes. A big headland with villas on top, yes. And the houses have steps down to a private beach. This could be it. How can I find out the high tide at the Rough? Yes. Yes. Right, thank you. Thank you, you've been most helpful.
Well?
High tide is exactly 10 minutes before Bradgate.
That's it. 2217. If one of those villas has a private staircase with 39 steps leading down to the beach, we've got them.
I'd wager my last shilling on it, Sir Walter. A pink and blue June morning found us 2 miles south of Bradgate, looking out across a headland to a smooth sea. A small destroyer was anchored offshore.
HMS Lion under Commander Flint. Ah, he's a good man. I knew his father. Look, I'll leave you two here and go back to Bradgate and find a phone. Just keep an eye open, but don't do anything heroic.
Would I? Emily and I walked down to the shore and along the sands, passing a few fishermen on the way.
Morning!
All right.
Is this the Rough?
Aye.
I don't suppose you know if there are any houses along this stretch of the beach?
Aye. Up on the cliff, around the bend.
Thank you.
Sure enough, we came across some staircases leading up a small cliff. We counted the steps. 45.
42.
33.
39.
That's it. Got it. The house at the top was called Trafalgar Lodge, a red brick villa with a veranda and tennis lawn behind, and an ordinary seaside flower garden to the front. From a white painted flagstaff, an enormous Union Jack hung limply in the still air for all the world to see. The house next door appeared to be empty, and the garden gave good cover for observation. From this vantage point, the destroyer was just around the headland and out of sight, but we had a perfect view of the wolf's lair. Presently, an old man wearing flannel trousers, a blue serge jacket, and a rather dapper straw hat came out of the house. He carried a pair of binoculars and a newspaper, and sat in the front garden and began to read. A perfectly satisfied old bird, sitting in a perfectly English garden. This wasn't what I expected at all. Not much happened for the next hour or two. The old man read his paper, went in and out of the house, and occasionally surveyed the scene through his field glasses. Then I saw it. A yacht came up from the south and dropped anchor pretty well opposite the Rough.
Righty-ho! That could be it. Their escape. I need to take a closer look at that yacht.
Are you sure?
No, but we can't just sit here in the herbaceous border all day. Come on!
We made our way back down to the beach.
Hello, I say there. Any chance you could take us out?
Fishing?
Yes.
Now?
Yes. I can pay you, obviously. £5, okay?
£5? Right, you are.
We rowed out, and I dropped a line over the side. The sea was like a mill pond, and above the white cliffs of the Rough, I saw the red and green of the villas and the great flagstaff of Trafalgar Lodge.
I say, could you row us over to take a look at that yacht?
Your money.
Afternoon. A beautiful boat. What's he called?
The Ariadne.
She looks fast.
70 knots flat out, don't you know? Hot, hot.
Impressive.
Fishing, eh? What?
Yes, caught a couple of cod. Nothing much.
Fine weather for it, though, isn't it, though, eh? What?
Yes, indeed.
The weather is most unusually clement for this time of year. We've been most awfully lucky, don't you think, eh? What?
Yes, awfully. Anyway, we must be getting back. Good day to you.
Yes, good day to you. Chin chin, pip pip, tally ho.
We rowed back to shore.
Well, he was odd. What do you think?
Well, if he's English, then I'm a Chinaman's uncle. All that nonsense about the weather and chin chin, what what. I'm certain that's the Blackstone's escape. Look, get back to Bradgate and let Sir Walter know the game is afoot. I'll go back up and keep watch.
Be careful, Richard.
Of course. I made my way back up the cliffs and installed myself in the neighbour's rather impressive flower garden, well out of sight of next door. Two men were now playing tennis. The older chap I was certain I'd seen before, and the younger fella definitely had a whiff of familiarity about him.
40-15. Game. Ah, well played, but give an old man a chance next time, will you?
Were these the two that had pinned poor old Scudder to the floor? It seemed so improbable. They were the picture of Englishness, more likely to be discussing share prices and cricket scores than plotting against good old Blighty. I'd hoped to be making a net to catch vultures, and lo and behold, a couple of plump thrushes had blundered in. Presently a third figure joined them. A young chap on a bicycle with golf clubs slung across his back.
Good round, old boy.
Dreadful. Dougie had an absolute screamer and thrashed me 4-3.
Ah, bad luck.
I say, if old Dougie can beat you, then I'll take you on tomorrow and give you a shot a hole. You are the most insufferable bore. You're on.
Ah, well, I've had enough for today. And anyway, I think the sun is over the yard arm. Must be 10 o'clock. Come on, let's go in.
This didn't seem right at all. It just didn't add up. Perhaps I was barking up entirely the wrong tree. Then I remembered what an old pal of mine, Peter Pienaar, had told me back in the Cape. He'd been a scout during the Boer War and had often been on the shady side of the law. It was all about atmosphere, he'd say. Hiding in plain sight. Cunning. I thought of Carolides and all of Europe trembling on the edge of a precipice. The Blackstone were on the verge of escape with the naval dispositions, and if they survived, this June night would undoubtedly cash their winnings. There was only one thing to do. Go forward. The sun was beginning to dip below the horizon. Lights appeared on the Ariadne, and further out to sea, the bigger lights of steamers making their way to the continent could be seen. It was then I saw HMS Lion round the headland. This was it. It was now or never. I approached the house. Everything appeared as above board as a charity tombola at a village fete. I rang the bell.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. I've come to see...
Mr. Appleton, sir.
Oh, Mr. Appleton, yes.
If you'd like to come in, sir, and wait here.
I'd hoped to march straight in and await a recognition in the faces of the three men, thus confirming my theory. But here I was, standing in a neat, middle-class hallway, surrounded by golf clubs, tennis rackets and Wellington boots.
Can I take a name, sir?
Twisden.
If you'd like to follow me, sir.
The maid led me into a smoking room, dominated by a very grand grandfather clock, and a picture of Queen Victoria above the mantelpiece. The police was as orthodox as an Anglican church.
Mr. Twisden, sir.
Ah, Mr. Twisden, you wish to see me?
Not a flicker of recognition, but there was definitely something familiar about this portly gentleman. Good evening. I think we've met before.
Maybe. My memory isn't what it used to be. Remind me,
I'm afraid, sir, the game is up. I'm here to arrest you for the murder of Franklin P. Scudder.
Who?
Now, let's not play games. It's so unseemly.
I assure you, young man, I do not play games. A spot of tennis, perhaps, or croquet, but I've never heard of this fella.
Were you in London on the 7th and 8th of this month?
No, I was convalescing in a nursing home in Kent after a rather nasty bout of scarlet fever. I've come up here to rest, young man. And I have to say, this isn't helping my nerves one bit.
Everything all right, Uncle?
Yes, but this fellow thinks I'm the Portland Place murderer.
What? That's ridiculous.
Yes.
I looked the old man straight in the eye. I never mentioned Portland Place, and Scudder's name has never been released. Baron. Silence fell. You could cut the atmosphere with a spoon. The clock chimed 10.
Well, Mr. Hannay, it appears you have uncovered our little plan. Bravo, bravo.
Where's the other one? There were three of you.
Oh, Carl? He's gone and taken the plans with him. And you have no time left to stop him. The Schwarzstein is in the Sigger's crone. Bad luck, old boy.
Well, I hope Carl will bear his triumph well, Baron. Oh, I forgot to mention. The Ariadne is being boarded by His Majesty's Royal Navy as we speak.
What?
And this rather delightful house is, by now, surrounded by Britain's finest.
Nine!
It looks like you, my friend, are going to jail.
Right, little funny chip! Get off me!
You're next!
Toodle-pip.
Richard, are you all right?
Hello, Em. Yes, I'm fine. Sir Walter.
Well done, my boy. Sorry for cutting it a bit fine. Just wanted to make sure we got the bounder.
That's all right.
And thanks to you, the plans are back in safe hands, and Britain's navy will hold fast. The nation owes you a great debt of gratitude, Hannay. You've saved the day. Of course, you can't tell anyone. Mum's the word and all that.
No, of course.
Right. Who fancies a nice fish supper? I saw a lovely little place in Bradgate down by the harbour.
Jolly good idea. I rather fancy a winkle.
Seven weeks later, the world went to war. I joined up, of course, got a captain's commission, and did my bit fighting on the Western Front. But I knew my best service had been done long before I put on khaki. Oh, and after the whole shooting match was over...
Richard, darling, pour me a gin. I'm just putting the little ones to bed.
Right you are, Em. Toodle-pip. And remember, Mum's the word.
You have been listening to The 39 Steps.
Hannay was played by Bruce McIntosh. Brenda and all the female parts by Scarlett Briant. And all other parts, including the dog, by David McCulloch. The play was adapted and directed by Chris Hawley. We hope you have enjoyed the show and might consider making a donation. All monies will go towards future projects and allow us to continue to pay our actors and crew, with 50% of all donations going to the Minster Trust, a local charity supporting people with learning disabilities. You can find out more details about the work they do and further information about upcoming shows below. This has been a Black Box Theatre Company production.